I did want to ask you about, because it's in the news every single day, and I know this is a huge issue for you. It's the least funny thing to bring up in the world, but I think about Ukraine every day just because it is such a big part of the news, and I know that this is where your people are from, you know, is Ukraine. And I follow the news every day, and I think we're watching, people love to armchair quarterback and talk about how in the 1930s and 40s, you know, we really should have stood up to, you know, fascism. And if I were alive then, I really would have stood up. You know, we really needed to stand up to Hitler in 36 or 78. And I really do feel like we're seeing this play out right now. And when people are indifferent about it or indifferent about Putin or in any way, I think you understand that this is the defining fight right now in the world. And 25 years from now, people are going to be seeing this as a very important outcome.
For the world.
I think for the entire world.
For the world, yes, correct, yeah.
I didn't mean to get all heavy, but I just thought, I kind of felt like I know this is important to you and wanted to talk about it, especially with the way the news has been unrolling
recently, I appreciate it.
Putin getting incredibly desperate and back on his heels.
You know, it's one of these situations where I think everybody wishes, and it's weird how this war is affecting some people, and other people are like, it's just a war over there. It doesn't affect me. And I understand that because I look at most wars over there and they don't affect me, right? And I keep trying to go, even if I wasn't from this country, even if I had no association with it, you have to look at this war as a defining moment for the West. I won't go into politics, but what this will do to China if X person wins. You know what I mean? Like, there's so many players here. And I was like, so just look at it strategically as like, this is a very important war. Not like, should you care about the people or the refugees? If you don't have time for that, I totally respect that. You're busy, you got bills to pay, you got food to put on the table. I get it. But just remember that this is the breaking point for whether or not democracy lives or where democracy falls on the global scale. And that's the only thing that I ask of people. Like, just keep reading the news, keep getting yourself invested. You don't have to do money or time. I mean, other than information. That being said, you look at what's happening in Iran right now. No one's talking about that either, because that's not on the global scale, right? Like that, that country's gonna handle. That's not anyone's problem because it's isolated. It's not gonna trigger a nuclear war. They look at Russia and Ukraine, and people got upset. Like, because when it was popular, I got pushback of like, this is only popular because, and they would give some BS reasoning. They don't talk about other wars or other natural disasters this way. And I was like, that is true. They should all talk about everything that's happening. But this has not happened in a very long time since the 80s, where there was this fear of a bigger problem.
Yeah.
But I go back to, no one's talking about the women in Iran right now or what's happening there either. So there's a part of me that goes, you can only solve so many problems. Otherwise, it becomes overwhelming. The idea of like, how do I help there? What do I do there? How do I assist there? What can be done? Becomes insanely overwhelming. And so I think that's where our focus just kind of naturally went to logistics, going back to like logic, like how do you deal with things? And as much as I want to deal with emotion and take every kid in and save every mother and go in there and like give everyone a hug, that's not the best use of time or energy at this point. And so we try to solve problems with logic. So we try to go logistics on everything. Otherwise, I would get incredibly overwhelmed.
So what's the logic and logistics you use in
Ukraine?
Ukraine, yeah. You and Ashton raised a ton of money.
Honestly, we wanted to band-aid a problem until the government step in, because realistically, war is a $1 trillion solution. By all means, it's not millions. And so it was like 24 hours in, and we realized that people were just not, people were just so confused as to what they can do, right? People in general, as human beings, want to feel like they're a part of something. They want to feel like they're a part of a solution. They want to feel good about themselves. They want to feel like they did their job. And it was showcased in social media when it was like, you know, repost this photo and that means you stand with these people, or turn your profile picture into this. And you saw that people naturally were doing the easy way, right? Like, they're like, if I click this, that means I'm for it. So I made a difference and I feel good about myself. So the thing that Ash and I wanted to do was to make sure people felt good about themselves, because it does take time, it does take effort, but also people want to post it, repost it, and showcase it. Cool. We did this with COVID, with quarantine wine, where we were like, okay, how do we raise money but also make people feel people like they're a part of something bigger, greater? And so we did it through that, and it was successful on that part. And so when we started this process, We just had to band-aid a problem and make people feel like they're making an immediate difference, right? So if you were like, hey, give me $10, I'm gonna go and buy a bunch of blankets and toothpaste. By the time I do all that, things will already be different 20 times over where the war is. People are super generous at donating. So there's tons and tons of warehouses full of blankets and toilet papers and all of the necessities that are needed during a crisis moment. But getting it from point A to B is always difficult. And so we are part of this company called Flexport, and they just do, you know, natural, you know, they fly cargoes, right? They fly, they ship cargo. They're just a cargo company. There was a natural disaster in, I don't remember where it was, maybe Puerto Rico, but I don't remember where it was. And they pivoted and started doing like an NGO version to try to help, because they realized that there was containers just sitting on the side, not being moved, full of, you know, blankets and all like the emergency things that people need. So we facilitated that. So essentially what we did was we put point A to point B with vetted NGOs on both sides that already had everything ready to ship. We didn't need your money for the product. We just needed your money for the shipments.
That makes a lot of sense to me, because I think there's a sense, it can lead to apathy. People, I think most people are good.
I think most people are great. Yes.
I think Americans are very generous people. They
for a
historically,
minute.
Yeah, they do want to help. There's just an apathy that comes from, is this really going to get where it needs to
exactly.
go?
Exactly.
And, you know, I know I've felt it myself, like I really want to help, but is this
no
really...
No one trusts anybody. Look what's
really,
happening everywhere right now. Like yeah. all of, the, you know, unfortunately, all of these big NGOs, the CEO is caught doing, taking 10% off the top, or this CEO is caught stealing the money. It's happening all the time. So I don't blame people for not trusting or being tentative about donating their hard-earned $5, $10, let alone mm-hmm. $100 or $1,000.
Yeah.
So we wanted to be super transparent. So we just kept posting videos about it and then showcasing the said plane going or the said cargo
right.
ship going. And so we're like, this is what we... And we did an outline of like how much money buys one flight round trip, how much money buys two cargoes. Like you knew exactly where all the money was going. And then the housing of the refugees with Airbnb.org. That's already existing, right? So it's using existing infrastructure and amplifying that.
Do you have any family in Ukraine?
I have distant family. We were the last of my family to leave, so we were 91.
Mm-hmm.
My family left, I have to think about it, right after World War II. So my family was in the Holocaust, right? So the ones that survived, some left in the 70s, some stayed. And then that was like one of the migrations was the 70s. And then the other one was like late 80s, early 90s, right at the fall. And so we were right at the fall. But we were the last of my immediate family to leave.